weekend is the summer, the winter Olympics.
Started today.
Today?
Today?
I don't watch TV. I watch news. Sometimes.
That's how fun I got that going early, yeah.
Yeah. We say yesterday morning news.
Okay, why don't we start with prayer and then we'll go into Revelation. Been after review, it's been a little over a month since we were on this, so let's start with prayer. Father, we are grateful for giving us this opportunity to come together tonight so that we can resume our studies in Revelation. And it's been a little over a month, so I pray, Father, that as we are situated tonight and those who are on their way, that you would allow them traveling mercies as well. And we think of Natalie, who is leaving today or left today, just after we just keep her safe. And keep us all safe as well, wherever we go. I know it's raining tonight. Father, before we engage your word, we know that it's key to be in fellowship. 1 John 1:9 reminds us that if we confess, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We understand that this doesn't change our sonship. We are always a son or a daughter in Christ, but at times we may grieve you. And if we don't recover from this, then the only thing we can look forward to is the discipline that comes as a result of your love. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. So thank you, Father, for this opportunity. We ask you to pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Let us review. We were on verse 5, and so let me just begin with Revelation 1, verse 5. And it's right here on the PowerPoint. We're just going to look at some of these by way of review. And remember, Revelation chapter 1, verse 5, it says, "And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth." And just so that we get the flow of this section, let me just read verse 4. Remember, we covered this about 2 months ago. "John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come." Do you remember who that was referring to? Verse 4?
Oh.
That's referring to the Father. I mean, most people will conclude that this is referring to Jesus. Mm-hmm. But that's verse 5. But in verse 4, "Grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come." That's referring to the Father. "And from the seven spirits who are before his throne," and that's referring to the Holy Spirit. We broke down the characteristics of the Holy Spirit as found in Isaiah. And then now we're on verse 5. So grace and peace comes from the Father, from God the Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ. Verse 5, that's where we're at. "And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood." So going back to verse 5 right here, "from Jesus Christ." And the third "from" indicates that Jesus is also a source of grace and also a source of peace. So that's the reason why I backed up in verse 4, because grace and peace comes from all three: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But the order in verse 4 is Father, then Holy Spirit, and then in verse 5, introduces Jesus Christ. So grace and peace comes from all three, the Godhead. So from Jesus Christ, and that's also a source of grace. And this is the reason why we go to him, right? This is the reason why we go to him and approach him in prayer. And through the agency of the Holy Spirit, and of course through the sovereign will of the Father, we can approach him. And so we're always extended grace, we're always extended peace because of the sonship, because of the daughtership, the relationship that we have with God himself. So John named the Father and the Spirit using figurative language, but he does not do the same with Jesus Christ. He names him, for Jesus is the subject of the book. That's why it sounds interesting, right? These spirits before his throne. But as we pointed out 2 months ago in verse 4, it's really referring to the Holy Spirit. And we just looked at the various characteristics of the Spirit. So the Father and the Spirit are used in figurative language, but with Jesus Christ, he is mentioned by name because it's a revelation about Jesus Christ, right? It's a revelation about Jesus Christ. It's a revelation from Jesus Christ. And so he is the subject of the entire book, the book of Revelation. And we're going to see at the end, of course, he is victorious. And we're going to see in the future the things that are going to happen here on earth when he starts to unfold and unpack the bold judgments, or the judgments that are headed for earth. Does anybody remember how many judgments there are going to be? How many judgments are going to happen here on earth during the tribulation? Anybody remember the latter half of the 3.5 to 7 years? 3.5 years, it's going to be a little bit more. It's going to be more of a time of peace. And then the latter half is going to be the tribulation period. And there's going to be 21. 21. Some people think there's only seven. The seven bowl judgments, or the seven trumpet judgments, vial judgments. But no, there's actually 21. 21 things are going to occur in hopes to rattle everyone's cage, those who are here, to bow the knee to him. And then, as I pointed out before, there are going to be people who are almost like psychotic talking to the stones. Hide me from him. Hide me from the Lord. And so, you know, instead of responding to the things that God is displaying, his awesome power here on earth, rather than repenting, they continue to just dodge and avoid God altogether. Remember, we saw, and we did a preview, there's going to be a horse-like figure going around attacking the men. Remember that? And what's going to happen when this horse-like beast is going to come? It is going to have a tail, that of a scorpion. Right? And what's going to happen when the scorpion stings the man? Remember? The men who get stung, they're going to be in such pain that they're going to attempt life. They're going to attempt to take their life, but they can't even commit suicide during this time. Imagine that. They're going to hate life, and they're going to want to take their own life, but impossible. God is not going to allow them to take their life. They're going to have to endure the pain. Now, okay, from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, and here Jesus makes three statements about the person of Christ and three about his work. So the faithful witness, and then firstborn of the dead, and then the ruler of the kings of the earth. So, faithful witness. So, regarding his person, he is the faithful witness. The word faithful means trustworthy. He is reliable in conveying a true representation of God. Remember when he spoke to his disciples, he said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Right? So, he's a perfect representation of God himself. We place our full confidence in his word. So he's trustworthy. This is the reason why you're here on a Thursday night. This is the reason why we go to church. This is the reason why we're involved with ministry, because we're trusting in Him. We are confident that what we're believing in is accurate. Otherwise, we would probably be doing something else. Right? If you guys watch the Bill Nye and Ken Ham debate, there's a debate just the other day, and there's comments from both sides, but I think overall Ken Ham did a great job representing Christians. And basically he's trying to make the point that we should allow children and kids to learn about the creation view rather than just the evolution. You know, the view of evolution being the beginning of all things. So, and the video is on YouTube if you look it up. I think it's up there right now. Definitely a good video to watch, about an hour or so long. So we place our full confidence in His Word. The only way we can know more about God is through the Word. Remember, Christ is the living Word. He is the reflection of God Himself, God the Father. But the Scripture is the written Word, and it communicates everything that God would want us to know about Himself and the things that are going to take place in the future. So this is the reason why it is so important for us to get into His Word, because that's the only way we're going to be able to execute those things that He would want us to execute. Plus, it serves as a good encouragement, serves as a good way to transform our lives. Don't be like the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So there's a lot of benefits from studying the Word of God. I know some people have said in the past, you know, why do you guys study the Bible so much? Why don't you just love people? Why don't you just do this and that? And we do. We actually do. And in fact, the only way we can accurately represent Him is by accurately handling His Word, so that we know what He expects and what He would want us to do. Jesus is trustworthy in His witness because He faithfully testified to all the counsels or the words of God the Father, and this is supported in the first chapter of John, John 1, verse 18. So he testifies to the Word of God, the counsels of the Father. He is trustworthy. He is the only witness who can go back and say that He was there. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And actually the Word was God. Right? So He has a unique position. And nobody knows the Father as well as He does. So as far as this person, He is called the faithful witness. And then we have the second one, which in verse 5 says that He is the first begotten of the dead. And Jesus is the first to rise from the dead permanently. That's why I put the word there, permanently, because other people have risen from the dead. Lazarus had risen from the dead. But remember, He is resuscitated. He wasn't resurrected. So resurrection, the only person who was resurrected and came back from the dead in a glorified state is Jesus Christ. Now people who come back from the dead, they've just risen, you know, and they were resuscitated, but they wound up dying again later on. So Jesus is the first to rise. He is the first to rise permanently, never to die again. And He took on what's called the glorified body. And we will be like Him one day. We will have a glorified body. So all our aches and pains and the challenges that we face when we get up in the morning or when we retire at night, all of that will eventually leave us. We will have a glorified body that similar to that of Jesus Christ. We don't know how it's going to look like. I've said in the past, maybe it'll look like when we were 33 years of age, because that's the time when Jesus ascended to the Father, but we don't really know for sure. But we do know that we will be like Him. And we have some idea as far as what it's capable of doing. We know that when He came back from the dead, the room where the disciples were, He was locked up. somehow he was able to get into the room even though the doors were locked. So apparently it's a body that can go from corporeal to, it can go from visible to invisible, it can go through walls, it can eat fish, it can consume food. So we have some idea what this glorified body can do. And it can levitate and go all the way up to the moon and probably beyond without having to wear a mask. And where do I get that? Well, in Acts, he is seen, he is seen rising, remember, and the disciples were staring at him as Jesus was ascending to heaven. And the angel said, why are you looking at him? Why are you amazed? Why are you staring at him? Don't you know that the same way he's leaving, the same way he's going to return? So this body was just going all the way up into the sky, and the angle, the perspective, and the direction of the disciples was upwards. And so we know that his body went up into the sky. And we do know that when the rapture occurs, we will meet him in the clouds. We will meet him up in the sky. That's probably going to be pretty amazing. We're going to be up there suspended, so we're afraid of heights. This is going to be the highest of all rides, I think. We're going to be up there, we're going to be looking down, and then he's going to take us away with him for at least for a period of 7 years, so that the 7 years here on earth can take place. And then during the second coming, guess what? We accompany Jesus Christ, and we come back, and we set foot with Jesus Christ for a period of 1,000 years, and we call this, or what's also commonly known as the millennial period, where it's a 1,000-year period that's going to take place here on earth, and people will have an opportunity who are not yet believers to respond to faith. So he's the first begotten of the dead. He rose from the dead. 1 Corinthians 15:20. This was permanently. Other people were raised from the dead only to die again. And this is not resurrection, but resuscitation. Jesus brought Lazarus back from the dead. But he died again. He was mortal. Okay?
Pastor, pretty good slide over here.
We are on slide 71. Using a new system here, so this is kind of new. Does it match yours? Do you see it? You're using your phone.
Oh, yes.
Okay, good. Yep. Jesus is called the firstborn five times and only begotten five times. Only begotten refers to the incarnation. That's when he was first introduced into the world. When did Jesus exist? When did we first see him in the scripture? Does anybody know?
Wasn't he in Genesis?
Genesis? Okay.
Wasn't there like a mention?
Well, there is a mention of let us. In Genesis 1:26-27, let us make man in our image. So, but it's probably the Father speaking. But the first mention of Jesus, or the first example of this, what's called a Christophany, the appearance of Christ in the Old Testament, is probably in the burning bush in Exodus. Because we find out later on in John 8 that before Abraham was, I am. And Pharisees got upset, and they said, that's blasphemous. You're making yourself to be God. You're making yourself to be like God. They understood that the I am is linked to the person in the burning bush. Remember, he told Moses, tell Pharaoh that I am sent you. Remember that? And in John 8, Jesus says the same thing. Before Abraham was, I am. And so they understood what that meant. When you look in chapter 8 of John, they get really, really upset, and they wanted to stone him to death because they thought he was blasphemy. But the interesting thing is that did Jesus try to correct that? He didn't say anything. He didn't say, well, no, no, I'm sorry, you misunderstood me. Not the I am in Exodus. But he didn't. He didn't correct it because he meant what he said. So the only begotten refers to his incarnation, his physical life. And five passages in the New Testament portray Christ as first in priority. Colossians 1:15 presents him as first before all creation, and he is also the originator of creation. So it also has the idea of being preeminent or first. So Colossians 1:15. So we covered the faithful witness. We're talking about his person. He's called the faithful witness, Jesus. He's also the first begotten of the dead, Jesus Christ. And then third, the prince of the kings of the earth. We talked briefly about this last time as well, but again, we're just reviewing. All world rulers derive their authority from Jesus. The authority of Jesus limits their authority. And the political leaders of the earth do not know this right now, but they will in a future date. Take, for example, Romans 13. Let's turn there. He places people in position. He limits their power. He is ultimately in control of all of the affairs humanity. And when we look at Romans 13, we are just reminded that he is sovereignly in control. So you take a look there, it says, Romans 13, let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from where?
From God.
And the authorities that exist are, what did you want to say, Raphael?
Appointed by God.
Okay, so all authorities that currently exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God, and those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. You want to be unafraid of the authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For he is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger, to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Therefore, you must be subject not only because of wrath, but also for conscience sake. So the thing here we can take from Romans is to recognize that he's sovereignly in control. So he is going to ultimately take care of all things. All things are going to be in his hands. He's going to judge all matters, and he's going to take care of it all. He's going to take care of us. In fact, when he starts to show some of this, it's when he takes the believers out. You know, the believers are going to be raptured out of here, and then he's going to begin flexing his authority, flexing his muscle. And at this point, they better repent, they better acquiesce to Jesus Christ, because at this point, where everything's set in motion, we can then count the years. 7-year tribulation, 1,000-year period, one last battle. And after that, the great white throne judgment. And nobody knows the day or the hour, right? But the moment we're raptured, then we know that things are now in place. So if we are raptured tomorrow, then the people here have 7 years to respond. Now, some are going to survive, some are not going to survive because of the things that are going to be happening here. And so some of our unbelieving friends or relatives and family members will remember, oh yeah, I remember Mark was sharing the gospel to me. Maybe he was right because he seems, he's gone. Maybe that rapture story was right after all. And so they're going to dig into their notes, they're going to find the Bible, and they're going to say, the common thread among all these people who have vanished are church people. Let's check it out and see what this is all about. And then Marissa told me that there was going to be a 7-year tribulation. Let's look that up. Let's Google it. Let's see what's left behind, and maybe we can start to piece it together. Oh my gosh, we've got 7 years left. In fact, right now, things are going to be a little bit, they're going to be calm for the time being, but the next, after the first 3.5 years, there's the latter 3.5 years is going to be really intense. So we've got time now. Let's find out what we need to do. And then they find out that they need to respond to Jesus, and they believe in Jesus Christ for salvation, and then they start knocking on your doors and saying, hey, you did not sign your name here, you're not in compliance with the code, we're getting rid of all religion, we want to live as one happy family, one world system, this is the laws of the land, we're eradicating all religion, there's only going to be one system, and you have to take the mark on your hand or on your forehead. This is just a way to show that you're in compliance, and if you don't have this, you can't purchase food, you can't pay for anything, but please give us a call. We'll visit you again. Here's our card. And hopefully we'll catch you next time. It's going to be frightening. Marissa, you had a question?
Oh, I was just thinking, is it going to be very obvious to people, especially the unbelievers, that they need to start doing something about it?
Well, I'm hoping it's obvious. The truth is, the devil is really at work today. He keeps everyone busy and preoccupied and distracted with things. Even the Christians. The Christians are more involved with things than him. So we have to, you know, roll up our sleeves, get involved, know him, and execute his will, make an impact to the people that we know, reach out to those who are without Christ, take care of the people who are in need of assistance. You know, all of those things that come under ministry and play ball. Because our time is short. We're moving quickly. I don't know, I've never predicted his return, but the way things look, I'm sure it looked like this even during the time of Paul, because Paul wrote some things there that were clearly like today. But it just seems like things are just falling into place so that the Antichrist can come into the city. The money system is changing. There's a number of things. The microchips for animals, you know, pretty soon will be for, you know, for people. I think I think I may have read they're putting chips in children or kids. Have you heard that? I think they're putting it into their, under the surface of their skin. It doesn't hurt them. It doesn't, you know.
It's the nanotechnology.
Yeah.
My accessibility is
And someone will eventually ask, well, if they offer that now, should we not take it? And the answer is, well, it's not the mark of the beast. So if during our time, the latest thing is to get a chip, like to, you know, to minimize, you know, credit card theft or something. I wouldn't think it's a totally bad thing, unless someone says you need to surrender your belief. You've got, we're now in the time where we're getting rid of all the religions of the world. Then I would be really concerned. then I would wonder what happened to my theology. Because if they're asking me to take the mark, then that means I'm in the tribulation. And one, either I didn't believe in the right thing, or two, my understanding of eschatology is off a little bit. Because there are several views of what's called end times or eschatology. And some believe that there is no tribulation. Some believe that we'll be taken out before the tribulation, and some believe that we'll be here till after the tribulation. So end time studies vary, it's very involved. And there's multiple, quite a few views. But from my seminary training and my own personal training, I'm with the conviction that we are going to be raptured out before any of these things occur. So we should not see the Antichrist. You know, someone will say, I think he's born, I think he's over here, I think he's in charge of this church, this big church. I don't think so. I don't think we're going to be around when he's here. So that's based on my studies. And I'm also with, I'm following the steps of scholars who studied it much more than myself. So I've heard of the different views, but I think the one that makes most sense is the view that we're looking at now, the view that we're living in now. The devil rules the world now, Ephesians 2:2. So the god of this age is Satan, 2 Corinthians 4. And what do you think he's doing now? He's placed a veil over the eyes of people, lest they believe. So what does that veil look like? Is it an actual veil? Are they stumbling over themselves? And the answer is no. It's just another way of saying that he distracts people so that they won't believe. You know, he wants people to be so preoccupied with anything and everything except Christ. So if he could place this veil, if he could distract the unregenerate or the person who is not born again, he's going to keep that person off balance long enough so that hopefully he'll take his last breath and the devil will be happy. But the scripture says in 2 Corinthians 4:4 and Ephesians 2:2, Satan rules the world now. And one day in the millennium, Jesus will be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's a title that belongs to who? It's Jesus Christ. But it doesn't belong to him now. He is not the King of Kings and Lord of Lords now. We know that that's his title, but it's a title that he will receive during the millennium period. Right now, he is not the King of Kings. He's not reigning on the seat of David. He's on the right hand of the Father. He's mediating on behalf of brethren, believers. So that's a title that will be given to him when he comes back and he becomes king. He's not reigning as king now, but he will be in the future. And that's the millennium. And then, continuing on, so from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins. So, Jesus loves us now. Jesus loved his disciples unto the end. His love is persistent and insistent. So his motivation in doing what he did is love. Imagine the reason why he did what he did, the reason why he went to the cross, the reason why that he died in our place is because he loves each and every one of us. Does that include the unbelievers? Yes. He died for every person. All the sinners, us included, and even the worst of sinners that we can think of, gas chamber or electrocuted, things like that. He loved them as well. And I remember, I think it was Dobson, one of the Christian shows a number of years ago, I think the question was raised, is it true that Jeffrey Dahmer is in heaven now? Did he really become a Christian? And he said, yeah, I heard the same thing. I heard that he accepted Jesus Christ as a savior. And people went to visit him and shared, and he became a believer. And people were irate. So no, well, even if he did, he's not going to make it. Anybody that is living a perverted life like that and eating people, God will not forgive them. And he said, no. I mean, it's as difficult as it may be for us from the standpoint of our perspective, especially for the parents of those who lost loved ones, I'm sure it's difficult. But there's nothing that the grace of God can do. Yeah, but I'm so sorry. I did it again. Grace, I know you are sorry, and I know you're going to do it again and again and again. This is the reason why you should stay in my word, so you can grow. And you won't be perfect until you're face-to-face with me. But in the meantime, you build yourself up so you get stronger. You grow spiritually. You go from spiritual adolescence to spiritual maturity. Remember Hebrews 5? The mature, the ones who are able for meat or solid food, the people who, because their senses have been trained, are able to determine and discern good from evil, right from wrong, because they use the word of God. And so we have to use this on a regular basis. It's not just something to hold our books up, but it's something that we should use because it's alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. A couple more minutes here. So he loved us. So to him who loved us, we talked about that. He washed us from our sins. What do you think of when you hear this phrase, he washed us from our sins? What comes to mind? What do you think, Arlene? Someone says, Arlene, how would you explain the fact that he washed us from our sins? That seems so, it's difficult to just even begin to fathom and understand. What does it mean to, he washed us from our sins?
He cleansed us by his blood.
Cleanse us by his blood, okay.
He just takes away everything.
Okay, takes away everything, good.
That's part of the first phase of salvation when he died for us.
Part of the first phase of salvation, very good. That's how he saved us, right? Okay, remember there's the past salvation, saved us from the penalty of sin, saved us from the present power of sin, and then the presence of sin, okay? Three phases of salvation. Mark, do you have a take on this? What do you think of when he washed us from our sins?
I was thinking of the Old Testament verse, without the remission of sins.
Yeah, well, without the shedding of blood.
Without the shedding of blood, there's no
remission of sins. Excellent. And remember, they had to do that on a regular basis. Can you imagine that? To make peace with God, they had to bring an animal to be offered as a sacrifice. Appease the wrath of God. But John says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So a one-time transaction, that Lamb of God has been sacrificed once and for all for all of humanity. So everyone who acquiesces to Jesus Christ receives the free gift of salvation, and they are placed into the family of God by adoption. So we're all family. So, he loved us and washed us from our sins. The second work that Jesus did for us was to free us from sin. The word wash means to loose or dissolve. Jesus dissolved our sins in the sight of God. So, you may have heard the verse before, he remembers our sins no more. As far as the east is from the west, he remembers our sins no more. And sometimes people will quote that, especially in a marriage context or if there's a tension among people, close people. You're not supposed to bring that up. God even forgets the past. But the interesting thing, and we'll end here, is that it's not that he forgets. It doesn't say he forgets the sin, right? He remembers them no more. The big difference. If he forgets, he's got Alzheimer's. But when he remembers it no more, it's an act of his volition. He's choosing not to bring it up. And likewise, when we're dealing with loved ones, we don't want to bring those things up because that just adds to the fire. Let's get to the root cause of the issue and then not talk about the past anymore. So, Marissa.
Would you say it's not something against you?
He doesn't have something against you?
He doesn't count it against you anymore?
Yeah, that's right. He doesn't count it against you anymore. That's right. That's why he doesn't remember it no more. Could he remember it? Yeah. Because omniscience never forgets. Right?
So what is the judgment for?
For what?
Like he judged you.
Well, he judged us through Christ. So everything has been dealt with through the person of Christ. That's the reason why we look to him. Because all of our sins, past, present, and future, have been judged on him, in him. See? So just like our sins were transferred to Christ and he bore the sin of the world, the moment if I responded to Jesus Christ tonight, my sins have been paid for, but I don't have that relationship yet until I respond in faith. Right? The moment I respond in faith, just as my sins were transferred to Jesus Christ, guess what gets transferred to me? His righteousness gets transferred to me. So if tonight I believe in Jesus Christ, boom, transaction takes place. I now have the righteousness of Christ. So when the Father looks at me, he doesn't see the sinner that I am. He sees the righteousness of his son because I'm now a part of the family. And there's no dealings with light and darkness, so his righteousness allows us to have that ongoing relationship with God.
Is that what Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians when he said that I'm a free man? He's talking about that?
Yeah, that's part of the freedom we have in Christ. We're no longer in bondage, we're no longer yoked to the law. I am now a free man in Christ. So, but do we still have the struggles? Do we still have the issues? In fact, it could be much more intense. You know, because now that we're aware of it, and now that we're indwelt by the Spirit of God, he allows us to know for sure that he's convicting us and letting us know it's not something we should be doing. So, sometimes it's much more aggressive. Okay. Anyways, we'll stop here on this slide. What slide is this? We finished the second work that Jesus did for us, which is to free us from our sin. Let's close in prayer. We'll take a break. And then we'll look at systematic theology in about 10 minutes. Thank you, Father, for this opportunity to look into your word and to review some of these things. And it's helpful for us, I know, and those who have requested this as well online, to just go back and review some of this, especially 4 and 5. So we're grateful for giving us this chance to look at this again and to see that the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit are all involved in giving us grace and giving us peace. So thank you for this time, and ask these things in Christ's name.